give God praise. Worship the Lord God Almighty. So this morning, I'm going to give you a little sermonette because God's been dealing with me for the last couple weeks. So, you know, if I get it, you all got to get it, right? You know what? The other day when Sister Joyce spoke in tongues after the service, this is when it's been building with me for a little bit. Why do people think conviction is a bad thing? Because it's not. That's how the Holy Spirit shows us, directs us, and gives us the reproof that we need to be in the middle of His will. And I think when people are feeling it, that they think it's a bad thing because I'm not where I should be. Well, see, that's the thing. That's the wonderful thing about God. Because if you're not where you're supposed to be, Cecil,
right,
He's going to move you right back to where you need to be.
That's right.
So don't ever think that conviction's a bad thing. And like I said, it may be just Him telling me this, but I felt the need to share it with my brothers and sisters in Christ. Those that are on Facebook, those that will see it on the cable channel, when conviction comes upon your heart, listen. Because that's what we need. Because certainly, like where I work, if I'm doing something wrong, I want to know that I'm wrong. Because I don't want to continue. Because just like I said before, if you're a little bit wrong here, when you move through time and throughout your life, if you're a little bit wrong here, 10 years down the road, you may be way off.
Yeah,
and we don't need that because God is coming soon. I don't know when, but I feel in my spirit that it's going to be soon because look at what's happening in this world today. So, Pastor Mike,
amen.
I apologize for that.
No,
I just felt that I need to. So, God bless you.
Yeah, I don't apologize for sharing the word, honey. That's what it's about. That's what it's about. We're going to go to God in prayer. Brother Charlie had sent me a request first saying his neighbor, Christine Osborne, and he's just sharing with me she did pass away this morning. When he texted me, the ambulance was there and they were doing CPR. So, if you would just remember that family this morning. Camden and Bradley got a message from Kevin last night, and he's doing better. He still has a trachea, but they're going to wean him off of the ventilator. They're going to take him off of that. And he is starting to speak some. He's starting to say some words, but he can't talk with the trachea, of course. But so they're really excited about that. Glenn and I had the opportunity, we went down the other day. And I had talked with Carmen and she asked me to come. And I went down and actually got to have prayer with him. And I was really encouraged when I saw it because he was awake, he was alert. And then as I had prayed and we talked, I got ready to leave, and Carmen told him, she said, why don't we give Pastor Mike a thumbs up? And he automatically did it, and I did it back to him. So that tells me that brain is working. So praise God. Praise the Lord for that. I'm really looking forward to God bringing him through that. So continue to pray for Carmen and Jeremy. They're staying down there with him. Keep them in your prayers. Sister May the Sage will be having cataract surgery tomorrow. I think it's in Blacksburg. So let's remember Mavis. Sister Linda McCone is still doing well. She's making progress and continuing to do better. So let's keep her in prayer. Georgia and Tom Jackson, they're still doing well. Georgia went to her family doctor the other day, and her family doctor told her that all her Her blood work and all her levels and everything look good. Her kidneys are starting to fail, and so are Tom's, but that can be with age. But her family doctor had told her as long as her potassium stayed where it is, she wouldn't have any issue there with her kidneys. So she's holding her own. So we're just continuing to pray for Georgia and Tom, if you would. Megan had sent us a request for Jill Price. She's one of her friends, and she's going to have a biopsy coming up this month. So Megan wants us to pray for Jill Price, so we'll keep her in our prayers. Do you have a request for uplifted hand today? Okay. And maybe those you would like to share with us, we are on the Facebook with us. It's all right. So, yeah, Margaret. Sister June, absolutely. She had broke her ankle, or broke her foot, and I had talked with her, and I think she's supposed to see a bone doctor or something this week, maybe on Tuesday or something, or maybe it was last week.
Last week
she saw it. Okay. So I know that she said it was a fracture in her foot, so yeah, we will continue to remember Miss June. All right. Yeah, Mother.
Uh-huh.
All right, let's pray for Judy, my sister, and pray for Dennis, too. I talked to them both over here last Saturday, so let's keep them both in prayer. All right, someone else? Yeah, Allie.
I'm a Christian for Michelle. She is my son's mother-in-law.
Okay.
She's having a lot of pain in her body, and she reached out to me the other day and asked me to pray for her and remember her that she needed healing from top of her head, bottom of her feet. So.
All right. Remember her. Yeah, Wayne.
Brother Mike, I have a praise report.
Hallelujah.
A doctor didn't like some of the stuff he said in my blood work, so he started doing tests and did MRI and they couldn't find anything, and they checked me out several different ways, and the only thing they really found out is I'm getting old.
I'm
the Lord for taking care of me. Yeah. I'm honoring today. But I have a nephew that lives in Petersburg that had to have both of his kidneys removed because of the condition they were in, and he is waiting on kidneys. So far, he hasn't had anybody to donate, or he hasn't been on the list. We just pray that God will make a way for this young man to survive.
Amen. Pray for your nephew. Absolutely. I remember you telling me about your mom once. You know, her and dad when came to church here. And she had went to see her doctor, and her right leg was swollen. And I remember that she said she had asked the doctor, you know, what was causing that. And he had told her, well, old age, you know, you're getting old. And I remember you telling me that when you guys got back in the car, she said, that doctor doesn't know what he's talking about, because my left leg is as old as my right leg. And I never forget that. And I thought that was Miss Eva to a T. So I thought, how precious that was. Let's pray for your nephew that God will just touch him. We know he can heal those kidneys. He can do that. So, someone else.
Good thing said the pray for Matthew. You got to see a hurt doctor. December is burning.
All right. Pray for Mr. Matthew. Has to see a heart doctor. Yeah, Dennis?
Brother Mike, friend for my dad. His wife was leaving. Come back out.
Oh, Brother Buford. Okay, let's pray for him. That line is tough stuff. Some of you dealt with that. So pray for Buford Wright this morning. Someone else?
Pastor Mike.
Yes.
You all would please remember our first swim meeting, Esther
Diane. Esther, not swim meet, swim.
Swim. We believe the S just what it gives you.
So,
win.
Yeah.
Ladies, we're going to win. So be in prayer for our service this evening at 5.
5 o'clock at the fellowship hall. And the invitation's open to everybody. It's not just for the church. It's the community or whomever, ladies. I think it's going to be a great ministry. Sister Barb.
I've got a request prayer for my friend Charlotte. She has COVID, and several of her other family members have it also.
Okay. Pray for Charlotte. Anyone else this morning? Yeah, Tina.
Remember my Aunt Lois and her family. She lost her husband Friday night.
Oh, pray for Lois. Anyone else? Yes, Iris.
Will you guys help me pray for my grandson, Foster? He's in the Marine Corps. He's out in California. And he's put in for a transfer back to the East Coast. Just pray that that'll go through.
Amen.
It's God
get him back. Yeah, man. Bless his heart. Absolutely. Absolutely. All right, let's all stand, and I'm gonna do something different. I'm gonna ask everybody that will to come to the altar right now, because we've got a lot to pray about, and prayer is what it's all about. I know we're here to worship, and I know we're here to praise, and I know all that. But listen, God works through prayer. It's all about prayer. And that's what the providence is. And that's what we do. So if you would just come on up, let's just pray for all these requests. It's given out, all these hands that went up. We just come up and we pray for all of them. I know you can pray right where you're standing. I know you don't have to come up here. I know that. But there's just something about the altars. It's just that altar. We come to the Lord and do that. And if you need prayer, we'll pray for you while you're up here too. We'll do that as well. If you'd like a special prayer. So let's just all pray together. Yes, you want to stand here? Okay. All right, stand here for the jeans. That'll work. I call her Jeannie Lee. Gracious Heavenly Father, Almighty God, we come in the name of the Lord Jesus in your house this morning. We thank you that we're able to be in your house today. Father, we thank God for any of those who would like to be here. They're not able to. So God, every one of these that were called out by name, every hand that was lifted, Father, we know that you're aware of these needs. We know that. But we come together as a church, number one, as believers, number one, as disciples, as your children, God. We come joining together with prayer today because, Lord, that's what you commanded us to be. And we thank you for answering prayer, the praise report for their brothers and sisters. That's you, God. And the work that you're doing with Campbell, that's you, God. Only you can do this. So we're just asking that you would see that healing arm in person, that healing power in Jesus. Because as you heal the new on earth, you heal today on earth through your Holy Spirit. So we're believing God's faithful, God, that you will touch you, and you're going to heal, and you're going to minister. Thank you.
Amen.
All we have to do is accept.
Amen.
Accept Jesus into your life. It says that simple. Let's go to God. Heavenly Father, we come to you, thanking you, Lord, for your presence here this morning. We thank you that you have blessed us so much that we can give back to your kingdom. Take it, multiply it, only you can, Lord. It's all yours to begin with. We'll give you the glory, the honor, and praise for it all. In Jesus, the sweet and holy name we pray. And all is said.
Amen.
Amen.
My soul, the psalmist said, thirsts for God, for the living God. When shall I come and appear before God? My tears have been my food day and night, while they continually say to me, where is your God? When I remember these things, this is what we do. I pour out my soul within me. That's what we need to do here today. Pour out our soul to him and let him transform us.
Thank you, Lord.
Good morning.
Good morning.
We'll sing, stand up. Stand up to Jesus.
Yeah.
I missed one Sunday, so I've been picked on. I'm ready.
Set up for you. I want you to take that home so that you can You can look over it and expect you to have it remembered by next Sunday. That's a joke. I'll forget to be here next Sunday. But if you would, just don't leave until you get your Christmas play part. I've got that for you. I want you to take that home and look over. We're excited about it again this year because we haven't done it in a couple of years because of the pandemic. So I'm looking forward to getting back to work on that. My goodness, Halloween right up on us. I was going to preach about that. About 10 years ago, I did a history on Halloween. I spent 6 months at least doing all kinds of research on that, trying to dig all that out. And the year that I did that, I actually went to a bunch of churches around the area. I was still working at Malta, and they would call, and I would come, and I would do the history. And it was pretty extensive. It was pretty extensive. And I thought, well, you know, by Halloween being tomorrow, I'll just take a piece of that, maybe a part or two of it, because it's a long, drawn-out process, and maybe I'll explain that to the church. And I was trying to get that together. I was trying to pull it all into place, and then I was driving down the road, and it's just like the Holy Spirit said, just tell them about the cross. I said, I got you, Lord. I can do that. I can do that. So, but the fact is, Halloween, I was thinking about this guy who was on his way and happened to be on a church night and Halloween fell. And this guy was on his way to a costume party. And he was dressed up like the devil. He had on a devil suit, you know, the horns and the tail and carrying the pitchfork. And you know, you've seen him in costumes that they have. And his car broke down. And it was just pouring rain. And that was back in the days before cell phones. I had to put that in there. It wouldn't make no sense. So anyway, he saw a church just right across the road where he broke down, and they were having service. The lights were on, and he could hear them singing, and he said, well, maybe they got a phone. So he just ran over across the road in the rain, and he ran into the church, and it was a small church, and it didn't have a vestibule. When the doors opened, you were in a sanctuary. And he ran in and opened and slammed the door, and they all looked around and saw him. Well, when they did, the congregation all ran. And they ran up to the choir loft and got behind the preacher, and they was all standing there. And there he stood in his devil suit back there at the doors. But there was one old gentleman that didn't run. He just kept sitting there on his pew. So the guy saw him, and he went over to him, and he said, sir, he said, aren't you afraid of me like all the rest of them are? And he said, look, I've been coming to this church all my life. But he said, I've been on your side the whole time. Now, I heard another version of that. I heard another version of it where he said, no, I'm not afraid of you. I've been married to your sister 40 years. So I don't know about that. We're going to talk about the cross. The old rugged cross. I don't think we can forget that. I know that in our day, in our modern society, and you know, we always talk about the gospel, and we always talk about the grace of God, and we always talk about the goodness of God, but you know, it never hurts to talk about the cross.
It's true.
People like to hear about the cross because it was the cross that where Jesus paid the price for our salvation. And if we forget that, if we forget that part of it, then we forget that we have sin. I appreciate Brother John obeying the Spirit this morning with his sermon, as he called it, and I encourage him, always give the word of the Lord, because that conviction goes right along with exactly what we're talking about with the cross. If you take the cross out of Christianity, you lose the conviction that comes along with that cross. If people don't realize we need the cross, then they don't realize that we need salvation. So yeah, when I felt that impression upon me, and it's just as the Spirit said, just tell them about the cross, I thought, yeah, that's what I need to do, because I need to hear it myself. So if you would, turn to the first letter of Corinthians, Corinthians chapter 1, 1 Corinthians and the first chapter. And we studied this in Bible study and spent a lot of time on that, so you may still have your notes from that. But when you're in that chapter, I want you to go to verse number 18. We're going to look at verse 18 through 25, okay? In 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 18 through 25. All right, start at verse 18. And he said, "For the message of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. For it is written in the scripture, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise, and I will bring to nothing the understanding of the prudent." And he says, where is the wise? And where is the scribe? And the scribes are the one who were experts in the law. Where is the disputer of this age? Who's the one that comes against it? Has not God made foolish the wisdom of this world? Boy, we know that to be true, don't we? For since in the wisdom of God, the world through wisdom did not know God, it pleased God through the foolishness. Now, the foolishness is what the world calls it. It pleased God through the foolishness of the message preached to save those who believe. For the Jews request a sign. Remember that? Pharisees told Jesus, what sign will you do that we may know that you're the Christ? Jews request a sign, and Greeks seek after wisdom. But we preach Christ crucified. Now, to the Jews, that's a stumbling block. And to the Greeks, it's foolishness. But to those who are called, to those whom the Holy Spirit convicts, that's what that means. But to those who are called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ. Christ is the power of God, and Christ is the wisdom of God. And because the foolishness of God, which of course there is none with him, but if there were, even the foolishness of God is wiser than men. And the weakness of God, which there is none, but even if there was, and the weakness of God would be stronger than men. The message of the cross. Let us pray. Gracious Heavenly Father and Almighty God, I thank you today I'm able to stand here behind this podium in your presence, Jehovah. It's been a wonderful time of prayer and of worship and of song. And Lord, you have permeated this place. Our spirits feel you in this house. So now, Lord, I pray as this message that you have given us today about the cross, I pray that you just bring it alive in our spirits once again, that we might realize just how important that message is, so that as disciples we can cling to that, and as evangelists we can share that with those who need to hear it. In Jesus' name we pray, Lord. And all the saints would say, amen. Look at your neighbor and say, cling to the cross. Cling to the cross. Don't let that cross out of your sight or out of your mind. But how many people today are really impressed by the cross? You see them everywhere. You see the cross. I even wear one. I wear one on a necklace. Hannah gave it to me when she was 9 years old. I still wear it. It's more of a sentimentalism type thing than it is, per se, of the cross. But when I worked, I wore one on my collar at work. And people would say, you wear that cross so they'll know that you're a Christian, or so they'll know that you are a minister. And I would say, no. I wear that cross so that when I'm having a bad day, I just look at that cross, and I realize what a bad day really was. And it helps me to know that through that cross, I also am an overconqueror through him who lives in me. So the cross is important, but how much does it impress people? Because you see it everywhere. You see it everywhere. People wear it as jewelry, as a decoration. And is the message of the cross being heeded today? Or are people really listening to the fact of what the cross is actually preaching? And the cross does preach to us. You can't see that cross in the right context or in the right spirit and not have a message come to you about that cross. Now, we know the cross that Christ was on is not as pretty as those that we have hanging here, and not as decorative as those that we have that we use for jewelry, but we still do understand that it means the same thing. Here's what Paul was saying to that church in Corinth. We just studied in Bible study these past two Wednesday nights. We're in the book of Acts, and we studied about Paul being in Corinth. He was in Corinth. He stayed there. He taught there for almost 3 years. And after he left, he actually wrote four letters back. We have two of them. And there's evidence in those two letters that there were two other letters. But he wrote those letters back to them for a particular reason. And here's why. The Greeks, he said that the message of the cross is foolishness to the Greeks, because the Greeks were what we would call intellectuals. They were very smart people, and they were seekers and lovers of wisdom. They studied and analyzed the world that was around them, and they analyzed human behavior based on logic and reason. And they have contributed enormous amounts to our sciences, to mathematics, and to medicine, and even unto law. A lot of the laws we follow today in America, our court system, our justice system, they're all based on Roman law, which the Greeks were able to bring into that society. They also invented a countless number of gods. They invented for themselves gods, because anything they could not explain, if they couldn't explain how it happened, or why it happened, or how it works, if they didn't have an explanation for it, then they made up a god for it. It had to be a god that controlled that which they couldn't explain. So that's why there were so many statues to God in Athens, of which Paul had seen. So to the Greeks, the message of the cross was simply foolishness, because when you bring Christ into that culture, when you bring Christ into a culture of intellectuals like we have today, you and I are living in one of the most intelligent societies that's ever existed in our country. There was a time that half the country couldn't read and write. But today, 90% of the country can use technology. I see seniors who won't have anything to do with a computer. I don't like those computers, but they whip that cell phone at. So technology is prevalent. It's in our society, and it's one of the most intelligent societies that's ever been. So when you bring a simple message of salvation into a society that has to have an explanation of why things happen and how it happens, and if you can't explain that logically, then they have a problem receiving that message. So the Greeks could just simply say unto Paul, how could killing one man on a cross possibly redeem mankind from sin? They could have answered that question. But instead of listening to the God that answered that question by way of the cross, they made up their own gods. And they took the true message from the true God as foolishness, because it made no sense to them. And that's why Paul wrote this letter back to those intellectuals. They were big on wisdom. They were big on reasoning. And Paul made it a point to tell them, I don't care how much wisdom you have. I don't care how much knowledge you acquire. I don't care how much you can figure out. You still will not arrive at a plan of salvation apart from the cross. It's got to be through the cross that your sins will be forgiven. You can't buy it. You can't fix it. You can't do enough that God will forgive you other than coming to the cross. You have to be there, and you have to accept its message. Now, the Jews had a problem with the cross. And the problem that they had, it created a stumbling block. In other words, it put something in their way that when they were looking to God, they would trip over it, and they couldn't see it for what it really was. And the Jews had a problem with it because of the law. Because of the law. In Deuteronomy, the 21st chapter, in verses 22 and 23, we find this. If a man has committed a sin deserving of death, and he is put to death, and you hang him on a tree, his body shall not remain overnight on that tree, but you shall surely bury him that day, so that you do not defile the land which the Lord your God is giving you as an inheritance. For he who is hanged is accursed of God. So, according to them, Jesus could not be the Messiah because he was hanged on a tree on that cross. And according to them, according to their law, he could not be the Messiah because he was accursed. He was accursed because he was hung on that tree. Now, if you're not a Bible reader and you're not a believer in Christ, if the Holy Spirit doesn't live in your heart, this seems like a contradiction to you. And this seems like a good question that you could argue with the theology of the Bible. But my friend, the Bible does not contradict itself. It is never contradictory. Scripture always interprets Scripture. So let me tell you how the Bible answers that. And Paul also answers that. He addressed both of these issues with the cross in one verse. The issues that they both have. And it's verse number 24. To those who are called both Jews and Greeks, Christ is the power of God. For the Jews, he's the power of God. And for the Greeks, he is the wisdom of God. Well, how does that play out? In Galatians, the third chapter, verses 13 and 14, listen to what the Holy Spirit had Paul write. Christ has redeemed us from what? From the curse of the law. The law said the one who hung on the tree was a curse. The law is right. But guess who redeemed us from that curse? He has redeemed us from the curse of the law, and he became a curse for us. And then Paul quotes that law that the Jews stumbled over. He said, for it's written, cursed is everyone who hangs on a tree. But Christ became that curse so that the blessing of Abraham might come upon the Gentiles. There you go, Greeks, in Christ Jesus, so that we might receive the promise of the Spirit through faith. Jesus said, I did not come to destroy the law, but to fulfill the law. Going to the cross fulfilled the law of the curse that God had said. When he goes to the cross, he will be cursed. He was cursed for me. He was cursed for you. But he became that curse that he might redeem us, so that you and I are no longer cursed under the law of Almighty God. As Joe was taught in Sunday school, we have been set free in the liberty of our faith because of what Christ did on the cross. So that explains it in the matter of the law. And in 1 Corinthians chapter 2, Paul said, these things we also speak, not in words which man's wisdom teaches. No, it's not by man. Paul didn't get his gospel from man, but which the Holy Spirit teaches. And he's comparing spiritual things with spiritual things. But the natural man, the unsaved man, the man who believes only in Christ in his head, the man that Christ is not in his heart, see, the natural man does not receive the things of the Spirit of God. For they are foolishness to him. He was foolish to the Greeks because they didn't believe in him. Nor can he know them because they are spiritually discerned. They're spiritually discerned. Can I say that like I would have probably said it in Ivanhoe? If the Spirit's not in your heart, then you don't know what's spiritual and what ain't. It's that simple. You can't take the wisdom and form a spiritual birth out of that. Jesus said we've got to be born again. If you're not born again, you're still in the natural. And no matter how much you read this Bible, it will never speak to you as it is intended to speak to you unless the Holy Spirit lives in your heart. And it will seem contradictory. And it will seem conflicting. And the cross won't make any sense unless he lives in your heart. And that's what Paul wanted them to understand. Discernment. Discernment is just not knowing right from wrong. We think discernment is, well, if you have the spiritual discernment is, you know right from wrong. Well, that's part of it. But spiritual discernment will take you to a different level. And spiritual discernment will help you discern between that which is right and that which is almost right. We have a lot of half-truths that are circulating out here today. And if you're not able to spiritually discern what these, as Pastor Jim Dunn would call, Professor Slobberjaws, if you don't have the Spirit in your heart, they can talk you out of what you believe in your faith. But honey, if he lives in your heart, they can't talk him out of you. It's not going to happen. And that's why Paul said the Spirit is what gives us discernment. Well, these two reasons that they didn't listen to the message, is that the same reasons people don't listen today? Well, yeah, pretty much. Human nature never changes. For those who don't come to Christ, those who don't believe they need a Savior, and for those who don't want a Savior, then sure, the cross has no bearing on their life. They have no reason to be concerned with the cross because they're not concerned with their salvation. They're not concerned with their sin. It makes no difference to them that Christ died on the cross for them. It's nothing to them. That's not what they desire. It's not what they see. In Colossians chapter 2 and verse 8, Paul said, beware. You know what beware means. You're going down the street and there's a sign on the fence that says, beware the dog. You're not going to walk in that yard. Beware. Beware lest anyone cheat you through philosophy and vain or empty deceit. How? According to the tradition of men and according to the basic principles of the world and not according to Christ. I like the way J.B. Phillips puts it in his translation, the J.B. Phillips New Testament. I like the way he puts it here. He says, be careful that nobody spoils your faith through intellectualism, through smartness, through knowledge. He says, or high-sounding nonsense. Because such stuff is at best founded on men's ideas of the nature of the world, and it disregards Christ. So you're not going to have a non-believer, or you're not going to have a natural man who is going to be able to explain to you what the Bible has just explained to us about the cross. He said they will deceive us. They will make us think that we don't believe the right thing. They will make us think that we don't have the understanding that we have through Christ. The age-old philosophy question, can God make a rock bigger than he can lift? I didn't think I'd get an answer on that. Because if you say no, He can't make a rock bigger than he can lift. Then you're going to say, well, there's something God can't do. And if you turn around and say, yeah, he can make a rock bigger than he can lift, then the philosopher is going to say, well, there's still something God can't do. So how does the Christian answer that? Well, it's pretty simple to me. He can if he wants to. You know, let's see here in just a minute. He's the sovereign God. He can do what he wants to, anytime he wants to, any way he wants to. It has nothing to do with what my question is. I don't come to Christ with questions. I come to him in faith. I don't understand how the death of a man on a cross is what God chose to save me, but he didn't ask me. He didn't say, how should I save the world? He did it without me even being there. He made that own decision. As Arlene and I were talking, people say, I got saved on such and such day at this altar. No, you were saved the day that Christ died on that cross. You accepted it the day you came to that altar. You accepted it the day you asked Christ into your heart. But had you not accepted it, it was still there, whether you accepted it or whether you didn't. Men's ideas are based on worldly principles. Men's ideas are based on worldly principles. Christ doesn't deal in worldly principles, thank God, because the world is temporary and everything in it is temporary. We are temporary. Brother Leonard Cole, Charlie remembers Leonard at work. Leonard used to say to us, go to school, get all that education, learn everything you can learn, and then die and forget it all. Well, there's good reasoning in that. There's good reasoning in that. Well, Walt back there understands it. He's probably heard Leonard say that. There's good reasoning in that because it is temporary. 2 Corinthians 11:3, Paul said, here's where we are today. Paul said, I fear or I am afraid that somehow, just as the serpent deceived Eve by his craftiness, so your minds may be corrupted from what? The simplicity that is in Christ. If we make salvation complicated, we drive people away. When you begin to put rules on how one can be saved, when you begin to put rules on how you must be to be saved, then you begin to bring in complications. Look at the denominations that are out here today. You can name them all. You can run them all off. And you think, how did we get all these denominations from one cross? Don't we all worship the same God? If they're Christian, they do. Don't we all come to God by way of Jesus Christ? If we're all Christian, we're due. It doesn't matter if you're Baptist, if you're Catholic, if you're Presbyterian, if you're Methodist, if you're Pentecostal, if you're Church of God, if you're Lutheran, if you're Episcopalian, it makes no difference if you're born again. If Christ lives in your heart, it makes no difference which building you go into to worship him. But if he's not in your heart, there's not a church or a denomination on the face of the earth that can save you. Only Christ, and he has to be in our hearts in order for that to happen. So Paul was right. I'm afraid, he said, that the serpent has somehow deceived you. This intelligent society today. Have you ever been on Facebook and read all the theology? Oh, there's a lot on there. I swear every day I ain't going back on there. Because I'll pick up some of that theology and I'm sitting there thinking, I'm going to write a 10-page answer to this guy. And then I think, no, because if he doesn't know Christ, I'm wasting my time on him. And you think, oh, what a terrible attitude. Excuse me. Jesus said, don't cast your pearl before swine. Jesus said that. Yes. So if I'm going to cast a pearl, it's going to be to someone who wants a pearl and knows what it is and wants it because of what it is. I'll gladly write 10 pages to answer someone who wants to know Christ and wants to know about salvation. But I will not waste my time debating someone who is against it. It's not going to happen. If they want to be saved, they'll have to come the same way I do. And they know that. And they know that. Philosophy is at our fingertips. It's right here. And the devil uses it every day. Think about how he tricked Eve. Think about it just a minute. You read through that, and we read it so quickly that we just zip right on by. Well, there's a lot more to that than sometimes what we just pick up on in the reading of it. This man and woman had been in that garden, who knows how long? I don't know how long it was before Satan came against them. I don't think they were created one day and he came the next day. That's just me. But who knows how long they had been there? But what I do know is he singled out Eve and he caught her looking at the tree. And you say, well, how did he know that? Well, read it. Read it. It says she saw that the tree was good for food. She saw it. She had to look at it. She was looking at it. She saw that tree. Now, Adam had told her what God had told him. And he said, don't eat from that tree. And Adam told Eve, don't even touch it. Go back and read it. So he kind of added on, but it was a good warning. He said, don't even touch it. But the curiosity of humanity, and we all have it. We think cats are the only curious animals. Oh, no. And we have that curiosity. And Satan saw her looking at that tree. And he knew that there was opportunity. So he eased in there. Now, we talk about the serpent. Now, Jeremy, one of our twins, my son Jeremy, is who taught me about the serpent. They had a little toddler Bible that I would read to them before bedtime. Lynn and I would take turns. And Jeremy loved the story in the garden. And they had little cartoon figures drawn, you know, in the pages. And one night I was reading it, and Jeremy said, what was the snake before he was a snake? Yeah, that's about how I felt. What was the snake before he was a snake? Listen, we say, well, the snake's a serpent. No. The snake is the result after what happened to him. He's always been a serpent. But he wasn't always on his belly. And scientists will say, well, if you put a snake on an MRI machine or under an X-ray, if you look closely, you'll find that in that snake, there's little pods in there where there used to be feet. Oh, come on, man. If God says, your curse is going to be, you're going to eat dust the rest of your life, if you're 3 inches off the ground to start with, that ain't much of a curse. But what if you're walking upright? What if you walked upright? Whatever spoke to Eve, had to have a way to talk. You ever thought about that? Had to have a way to talk. Anyway, I believe that the serpent, before it was a snake, is the Neanderthal. The missing link that science can't find. We know they lived. We know they was on the earth. We know that they walked upright. The facts prove that. But what happened to them? Where did they go? Well, we evolved from them. Now listen, that's a nice thought. But look at this. You think this could have come from a tadpole? I mean, you think it could have grown in a premortal soup? and crawled up on the bank, broke legs, climbed a tree, swung out of the tree, hit the ground on his legs, and run. That takes more faith than it does believing God.
It's true.
That ain't the way it happened. So what happened to that leaf? Well, the Bible told us what happened to it. It was walking upright, and God said, you're going to crawl on your belly. Bam. He fixed it, and he came to Eve, and he said, hey, hon, my, you're a good-looking creature. Wow, you're intelligent. Now, I know all that ain't in Scripture. But this thing doesn't just show up and say, eat the apple, and he said, okay. So he gained Eve's trust somehow. Eve hadn't seen anything like this. She knew Adam. She saw the animals that were there. But this thing was different. And this thing walked up when she was looking at the tree. And this thing said, what are you looking at? And she said, that tree. What about it? Well, we can't eat from that tree. We can't eat from it. See? Because God said, you can eat from all the trees in the garden, but don't eat from that tree or even touch it. That's what she said. And Satan said, is that what he really said? Go back and read it. Did God really say that, Eve? Are you sure he really said that? So let me put that into philosophy. Now listen, God said you can eat of every tree in the garden. Right? Did he say that? Yeah, that's what he said. Well, if he said you can eat from every tree in the garden, now he says, but you can't eat from every tree in the garden. So which is right? Either you can eat from every tree in the garden, or you can't eat from every tree in the garden. Oh, well, I can eat from every tree in the garden. It's just this one tree that I can't eat from. Oh, okay. Well, you can take that route if you want to. But why don't he want you to eat from that one tree? I mean, why would he put it here and say that you can't eat from it? It's here with all the rest of the trees. It looks good. Why wouldn't you want to eat of that tree? Just like you eat of all the rest of them, because God said not to. Well, you know why he said that, Eve? It's because all the knowledge that you need to know about God and everything else is in that tree. That's where it comes from. In other words, it's almost like he said that tree is God. I mean, it's that tree that holds all the secrets to this garden. It's that tree that has all the information about where you came from. It's that tree that answers all those questions because it has knowledge. It has the knowledge of the good and the evil. And God doesn't want you to know what he knows. Because see, if you end up knowing what God knows, you're going to be equal to God. Isn't that about how it would have went? I mean, if you know everything that God knows, then you're going to be on the same level with him as far as knowledge goes. And he talked her into it. And she thought, go back and read it. She thought, maybe that's what I need to do. So she ate of the tree. And she got what she asked for. She got all the information that was in that tree. She understood the difference between good and evil. She had not known either one up to that point. You ever thought about that? Eve didn't know what good was. Eve didn't know what evil was. She didn't know there was such a thing. But when she ate that fruit, it was revealed to her. There is also bad. There is good, but there is bad. And you have just been bad. Because now you realize you have broken your first rule. Don't eat from this tree, but you went and did it. You're a bad girl, Eve. You're bad. You shouldn't have done that. Well, she did what anybody else does when they get a fix or drag somebody else into it. So she took a piece of whatever it was to Adam and said, here. And said, we can't eat of that tree. He said, oh, but you don't realize what this is. You don't realize what's in it. Listen, I know everything, Adam, but it's still new. I know everything, Adam. It's in here. It's all here. Just so Adam partook of the fruit, and he ate. And at that moment, the Bible says their eyes were open. That don't mean they were walking around physically blind, but there was a spiritual discernment that they had never known that came upon them at that moment. And at that very moment, they realized they were no longer in relationship with God like they were before. Something has changed. And then it says that they both knew they were naked. They didn't know that to start with. They didn't know there was a such thing as not being naked. They didn't know there was a such thing as clothes. They didn't see the human body like you and I do. They had no idea about it. All they knew was they were a happy people in a happy place, living a happy life. And then all of a sudden, all that came to a screeching halt because they listened to the voice of the devil. And God knew they was going to do that. Listen, that cross was in the plan before Adam and Eve ever came into existence. This is not a plan B. It's plan C. The cross has always been there. He didn't say, well, I'm going to have to do something because they done went. He knew that was going to happen. He knew they were going to disobey. He knew they were going to find out the difference between right and wrong. He knew that the rest of humanity was going to follow the same path that they followed. He knew that. That's why he sent his son, made in the nature of a man. He had to have a man die for a man that he could forgive man. That's what he had to do. But he knew that from the beginning. And then they went and put their clothes on and hid from one another. They hid their bodies because then they realized they were naked. Well, who said there was anything bad about being naked? I know if you saw me naked, you'd say, now we know why. But if it was the fact in them that they did not know, there wasn't anything to make them sin. But now, for some reason, that which God had created, they had thought there was something bad about it. Because that's what they believe. And that's what they forgot what God had said. So they had to do something to fix it, and they tried. And it wasn't acceptable. And go back and read it. And what did God do? He took the skins from animals. He poor old animal. I don't know which one it was. Could have been a sheep. Could have been a buffalo. I don't know. But all I do know is the animal died that the covering might be provided for these two stupid people that didn't do what God told them to do. Innocent animal. He's out there eating his grass and enjoying his life. And God said, oh, by the way, I need your hide. No idea. So there was a blood sacrifice made for the covering of Adam and Eve. God had it in the works. All along, and then he went to the serpent. And he said, because you have done that, you're going to be cursed from now on. And while you're on the earth, you're going to crawl on your belly. And I don't believe that happened over time. I believe he went from here to there. Boom, I believe dust went up when he hit the ground. I think God said, you're going to eat that. That's going to be where you spend the rest of your life on earth. That's where it's going to be. That's where that creature is today. That's how he ended up there. And he went to Eve. And he said, you know, because you've done this, you're going to bring forth children in pain. How many of you had kids, girls, girls? Did it hurt?
Yes.
It wasn't as loud as I thought it was. Sure it did. He said you're going to bring forth children in pain. And if you think if you think, well, I'll fool him, I won't go with anybody so that I won't have children. He said that your desire will be for your husband, your desire. Go back and leave him. Well, you'll want it. It's going to be that. You may think not, but it's going to be put together in such a way that you're not going to avoid that pain. It's going to happen. And it happens. And then he went to Adam. And he said, you got to get a job, buddy. You know, everything that you've had handed to you, handed about, you ain't had to do nothing. You kept this garden. I mean, you just walked through it, and you know, it's a beautiful place, and you just eat what you wanted, when you wanted, and slept, and rested, and played, and joy, and it was, you know, this utopia that you lived in. No more, big boy. You're going out of it. You're leaving. You're going to be put out, and you can't get back in on your own anymore. And why did you do that? And Adam said, it's that woman you give me. That's the first excuse, guys. We're covered. It's biblical when we make an excuse. Adam said, that woman that you gave me. In other words, if you hadn't given me this woman, I may not see it. Huh? But anyway, he did. And he was out of the garden. And you know what happened from there? God put the big flaming, the cherubim, and guarded the way to the tree of life. You know how you get to the tree of life now, guys? It's still there. It's in heaven. We read about it in Revelation. It's there. It exists. There's still a tree of life that you and I can't get through. We have to go through Christ if we're going to get through it. So in a sense, this cross, which was a tree of death for him, becomes a tree of life for us. We go through that because he died. And that's how we're able to get to heaven. For many today, the church can be a stumbling block to Christ. I know that hurts. It hurt me when the thought came to me. The church, not saying it's Draper. It can be any of them. But you think about the churches today that say nothing about the cross. They say nothing about sin. They say nothing about judgment. They preach God as being the same God that was in the Garden of Eden. And he still is. But things have changed, guys. We're not in the Garden of Eden no more. As Joe Salt Sunday School, the earth is not user-friendly anymore. It's trying to kill us. The earth don't want us on it. It wants to get rid of us because humans is what brought the pain to start with. And yes, the earth convulses. It quakes. It spits out smoke. It floods us. It burns us. It does everything it can do. Because the earth is no longer user-friendly. And it all started in the dark. But God said, I'm going to have a way to get by that. But the church sometimes compromises its principles in order to evangelize. You can't do that. You can't play in what the world has and think that you're going to win somebody to Christ because it has just the opposite effect. Well, Paul said he became all things to all men that he might win some. Paul did not mean he become a drunk to win a drunk. What Paul meant was, I didn't set myself above anybody, but I went to everybody. And yes, I obeyed what they had in their culture. In other words, if I'm witnessing to an unsaved Methodist, then I honor what the unsaved Methodist believes. If I'm witnessing to an unsaved Pentecostal, then I will honor what the unsaved Pentecostal may believe. I'll listen to what they think, but then I'm going to give them the message of the cross. And I'm going to introduce them to Christ. And I'm going to let them meet the same Jesus that I have met. And I'm not going to compromise who he is or who I was before he saved me in order that I might win them. And that's not what Paul meant at all. Paul just simply said, I'm not going to compromise with them, but I'm not going to shun them. I'm not going to turn against them. I'm not going to run from them, but I'm not going to become a sinner in order to win a sinner. That's not why Christ saved me. But the church sometimes can be a stumbling block. Think about it. Well, how many times have you heard, "I ain't going to that old church. I don't need people in that church. I don't know how they are." Talk to a waitress at a restaurant on Sunday. Just if you go out to eat after this service, I don't care where you go, you name it. You go somewhere, whoever your waiter or waitress is, you ask them, "By the way, what's the worst group you have to deal with in here? Get ready." You know what they're going to tell you? Shouldn't be so. The church group. Why? Because they think somehow that they're above. Shouldn't be that way. We can put a stumbling block in people's past if we're not careful. Here's what Paul said, and I'm closing, and you're glad. Paul said, "And you being dead," Colossians 2:13, "and you being dead in your trespasses in the uncircumcision of your flesh." Dead to sin. Dead as humans. And the uncircumcision of the flesh is the uncircumcision of the heart. He has made alive together with him. How do you do that? Forgiving you all trespasses. That's how you get it. Through forgiveness. Having wiped out the handwriting of requirements that was against us, which was contrary to us, and he has taken it out of the way. And how did he do that? He nailed it to the cross. We need the cross. We got to have the cross. We got to cling to the cross. It was that old rugged cross that got me into heaven. And I know him because he lives in here. Well, that sounds like an arrogant statement. No, that's a statement of faith. That's not a statement of arrogance. A statement of arrogance would simply say, "I'm going to heaven whether God likes it or not." If God don't want me there, I won't be there. But he has provided a way for me to come. He has provided for me a way to get there. Alistair Begg does a great teaching on that. If you ever go on YouTube, look up Alistair Begg. You'll like him. He's a Scottish preacher. And you'll love the way he preaches and his illustrations. And he said, "I can imagine when the thief got in heaven," and he said, "This is just me." He said, "I imagine when the old thief got in heaven, and all the rest of the saints looked at him and said, 'How'd you get here?'" And the thief was going to say, "I have no idea. All I know was I was hanging on a cross, and I told this guy, 'Remember me,' and here I am." Now, that may sound ludicrous, but listen, that's how God takes people to heaven, is through Christ. It's not against, you know, like he said, the thief wouldn't enter church. The thief was a thief. He lived his whole life as a thief. He wasn't a Sunday school boy. He was hanging on that cross being killed for what he had done against the government. He was on that cross legally. He was supposed to be on that cross. So was Barabbas. But he was supposed to be on that cross. He was supposed to die for what he did. And he looked at the Savior and he said, "Remember me when you come into your kingdom." And that's all Jesus needed to hear. And then when the thief died on that cross, he went to heaven. So if the thief would say, "Well, how'd you get here?" "Well, I don't know. I was hanging on a cross, and I told this guy to remember me." And he remembered him. He remembered him. And he remembers us. When we come to him, he hears us. And it's all because of the cross. Stand with me. Father, today has been, that's been a little lengthy. That's okay, because eternity is going to be a long time. And I'd rather sacrifice an hour or two here than to be lost for eternity. Absolutely. So I don't know, Lord, how everyone's hearts are in this place. I look at all these faces, and if you were to ask me, well, yeah, I love them all into heaven. I mean, I love them all. But I don't know their hearts, but you do, just like you know mine. And it's not what we say or what we think, but it's you. So I pray that those tuning in on the Facebook, and those who watch on the cable, and those who may pull it up on YouTube sometime or another, and those who are here, Lord, that they would just be assured that you are in their hearts. That they would see this cross. They would see this cross as a tree of life. It was a tree of death for you, but it's become a tree of life for us because of what you did on it. So I pray that we as Christians, regardless of how long we've been saved, we never forget that. We never forget that cross. That we would never look upon that cross with anything other than a hurt in our heart for the price you had to pay for us. How ugly that cross was that day because how ugly sin is. But Father, you paid it for us because you love us. As Brother Ron saying in the song, you love us, and you do. So I pray that those who have never accepted you would accept you. I pray that they would not be deceived as Eve was, and they would not be pulled into the lies of the world, and they would not let the church put a stumbling block between him and you, but they would go past all that, and they would look unto Jesus. You are the author, and you are the finisher of our faith, and you are who we look to. So as we go from here as disciples, nurture us, Holy Spirit. Help us, encourage us, and motivate us that we might share this gospel with those who don't have it. And Father, I pray as evangelists that we would introduce others to Christ. We don't have to introduce them to the church. We don't have to introduce them to our belief. We don't have to introduce them to any rituals we may think. But we just have to introduce them to you. And just by simply saying, well, I realize all this that's going on. Have you talked to Jesus about it? Have you prayed to Christ? Have you reached out to him? Because I assure you, if you do, he'll hear you. And regardless of what you may believe about him at this moment, if you'll reach out to him, you'll believe differently. Because you'll realize that he is real, and that he does hear you, and that he is alive, and that he will save you, just like he saved all the rest of us. And we'll thank you, and we'll praise you, and we'll give you all the glory, because it's in your name, Jesus, that we say all of these things. And those who love the Lord, we say we love the Lord.
We love you, Lord.
Amen. Don't forget, swim this evening. 9:00 at the fellowship hall. God bless you. Thank you.